افتتاحية لمؤتمر نيفرو أليكس التاسع، وهنبدأها بجلسة بمحاضرة الأستاذة الدكتورة هيام العجان. Is wearable technology the future of dialysis?
Good morning. I start my presentation. Can I start my presentation?
Start, please.
Yes. Start, doctor.
Okay. I want to thank the organizer committee, Professor Salah Nagar, Professor Iman Al-Gohari, and Professor Muhammad Said, and all the members of the organizer committee, and congratulate Professor Hala Al-Wakil for being the head of the nephrology unit, and welcome all the presenters and the speakers in this conference. I want to present this talk to the soul of our late Professor Amr Abid, Rabbina Yaghfirlo Yarhamu Insha'Allah. My talk about the wearable technology future dialysis. It is bioartificial, but I want to add implantable bioartificial kidney. Why we need a wearable kidney in end-stage renal disease? Because in end-stage renal disease, the only option has to be a short term for dialysis and a long term for renal transplantation. About 2 million people around the world being treated for end-stage renal disease with a great shortage of kidney supply. About 7 to 8% annual increase in the patients with end-stage renal disease due to population aging and increased diabetes prevalence. In USA, about 100,000 people are waiting for renal transplantation and they can wait for 5 to 10 years. So we need a wearable or an easy to use kidney like this, the machine. This is the old machine, and this is what we need in the early or now of this wearable machine. So it is must to be effective, patient friendly, permanent, and cost effective way to treat end-stage renal disease. How can this need be met? First, the first generation are very heavy, 10 to 25 kilograms. It is portable, can put in a bag and cannot be wearable. And the second generation slightly, but still heavy in weight, up to 10 kilograms. And then the wearable is small, 1.5 to 5 kilograms, and can be worn by the patient. And our hope in the implantable bioartificial kidney. The wearable kidney, the main component of wearable artificial kidney are as follows. Belt around the waist, so it is wearable and not heavy. Dialysis membrane, ultra thermal membrane, so that the dialyzer will be small. And dialysate generation, so just 400 milliliter, so it is not so heavy. And vascular, good vascular access give the flow about 100 milliliter per minute, less infection and less clotting. The patient monitoring, bubble detector and blood leaks, and also a power source, miniature battery-powered pump. And a pump system, also a micro pump, to control ultrafiltration, anticoagulant and substance delivery. There is different development this wearable artificial kidney. In the USA, one of the hemodialysis, and the other one, automated wearable artificial kidney by the Singapore for the peritoneal dialysis, and another in the Vincenza, wearable artificial kidney in Italy, this for peritoneal dialysis, and another nano dialysis for in the Netherlands for hemodialysis and peritoneal combined, and the Carry Life Renal, it is in the Sweden for peritoneal dialysis. We'll discuss the Vincenza wearable artificial kidney for peritoneal dialysis, and you can see here that there is a small waterproof bag, and it is holding a rotatory pump for a circuit for dialysate regeneration with cartridge connected in parallel with a mixture of activated carbon and polystyrenic presence to remove the toxins, and a filter for the aeration and microbiological safety. And there is a palm computer for remote control. And they found that by this condition, the urea creatinine and beta-2 microglobulin very good clearly from the body. And this is connected with the tube to the peritoneal catheter and can be put in a small bag like this and be wearable. The other one from Singapore, it is formed of put the patient a single, the two single catheter or one double catheter. And it is this peritoneal fluid abdomen goes through a pump and part in the blood reservoir, and the other is going to the sorbent assembly for regeneration of this peritoneal membrane and restore the aqueous or poor protein part that is lost by in the dialysis. And it is carbon filter and fibrin debris thread. And then back to the dialysis to the patient, there is enriched motive pump to add what is nutrient or substance we needed for this dialysis fluid. And then sterilization filter and gas removal module before it's going to the patient and then recurrent of this site. Then another device, wearable ultrafiltration artificial kidney. And we see here the patient is walking with this device and it is strapped around his belt and it is about 1.1 kilogram and put a high flux dialyzer, hemofilter, and there is dual human central venous catheter and then miniaturized blood pump, small blood pump, and battery powered mini pump, and then can remove fluid 120 to 300 milliliter for 4 to 6 hours. And the patient are stable and move this extra fluid. Now the wearable artificial kidney, we need here regeneration and dialysis fluid. So it is for a small dialyzer, 0.6 square meter. It is filled by about 52 milliliter and it is with about 5 gram. The pump with a dual channel rechargeable battery, this above the dialyzer. And then we have this cartridge, the three cartridges seen on the right of the this figure. One for the dialysis regeneration sorbent containing cartridge. One for urease, for the extract urate into ammonia. And the other zirconium phosphate ammonium to remove the ammonia with calcium, potassium, and magnesium. The third one, the hydrozirconium oxide, having removed the heavy metals, copper, lead, and phosphate. The treated charcoal to remove solute organic compounds. And it is dialysis circuit by less than 400 milliliters, and there is micropump and catheter for blood leak and bubbles. This device was used by Professor Bura. It is formed on 7 patients. 5 are completed for 24 hours use. And there is a good average blood flow and dialysis flow 42 and 43. And there is a good clearance for the urea, creatinine, phosphate, and beta 2 microglobulin. And the ultrafiltration about 1 liter to 1 liter and near 400. And the advantage of this device is longer dialysis session, can 24 hours be used, control blood pressure, weight, and nutritional status, reduce stress flow of the heart, and remove the excess fluid and clear the blood of toxins and waste. The patient satisfaction was measured, and patients are this convenient, freedom for him, less side effects, and very convenient and less discomfort for the patient. It is safe with no any serious adverse effect. This is slight leg cramping and 5 are mild arrhythmia, but no hemolysis. Now we're going into bioartificial kidney. The bioartificial kidney or organ are made from living cells and are grown in a laboratory. The bioartificial kidney are biological artificial hybrid that combine continuous blood filtration and tubular metabolic and endocrine functions. A container of scaffolding is used to guide the cells into the desired arrangement as they reproduce. The scientific challenges are now met are silicon nanotechnology make it possible to mass produce reliable, robust, and compact membrane. So this small and compact dialyzer. Novel molecular coating for silicon make it blood compatible and protect membranes without disrupting function. Advances in cell sourcing is very important, and storage capability provide necessary cells at the proper condition. This was first done by Professor David in Michigan University, and the first showing the usual hemofilter, the blood going in and back to the patient and the filtrate out and then discard. But in the bioartificial kidney, the blood coming from the filter and then going into another filter, the renal assisted device, and then back from this device to the patient. And this is the kidney with the filtration and then going to the tubules, the same. This is the hemofilter and then going to this renal assisted device. And you can see here that the blood going into side of the dialysate and the dialysate coming, going in the filter in the side of the blood. You can see here a cut section of the hollow fiber with a confluent monolayer of porcine renal proximal tubule cells along the inner surface of the fiber. And the other one, this is an electron microscopy of confluent monolayers of porcine proximal renal proximal tubular cells along the intraluminal surface, and this is the fiber of the dialysis. The renal assisted device or the bioartificial kidney. If you get cut section, we see that, as we said before, the blood outside, and then the membrane, and then the cells covering this membrane, and the dialysate passing inside, so it passes from the first hemofilter into the lumen of the red or the renal-assisted device. The main problem of the cells, this paper showed that the use of embryonic stem cells, pluripotent cells, as a source for development of cells that usually reflect the differentiated human tubular cells, but it faces many political and ethical considerations. So they conclude that the differentiated stem cell shows morphological and functional characteristics of renal proximal tubule and generated tubular structure in vivo and in vitro, and they do staining of the antibodies to the aquaporin-free for the human stem cell, embryonic stem cell, and the tubular cells, and this shows it is positive. It means it is a functional, good functional cells. The need for a big amount to be stored and reused, we developed the bioartificial renal epithelial cell system technology based on denobium-coated carbon and cryopreservative polycarbonate, can preserve in minus 80 to minus 140, seeded with human renal tubular epithelial cells derived from adult progenitor cells. This cryostorer device, you can see here, this is cartilage, carbon cartilage, different carbon cartilage, and it is separated by this separator. And this is a section of the carbon cartilage of cells on it. And this gets a perfusion, well distributed to all of these cartilage. And then they see these cells on the cartilage and they detect its function and effect. Now, it used this bioartificial kidney, the animals. And this goes with acute renal failure. They get the blood by pump into hemofilter, and then heparin and saline pass to this hemofilter, and then it passes into the bioartificial renal tubular device and another animal without this device. And then the blood after passes to this device, part are wasted, and other part with the blood going back to the animal. And they found this extended lifetime the animal using the device in relation to the animals without this device, and there is decrease in fresh cytokines like the interleukin 6 and others after this operation. Also, it is used in human with the hemofilter and the red system, and they found that glucosone degradation and endocrine conversion in this patient, which means that these tubular cells are working good, and there is formation of active vitamin D. And six patients survive about 30 days, with, they have acute renal failure, and improve. But four deaths is but not related to this machine. In addition, they concluded, in addition to the human renal tubule cell therapy, to CRRT has been accomplished and demonstrate activity with systemic effect in patients with acute renal failure and multiple organ failure. There is another technology developed, microfluidic technology, was developed by integration of different technologies as molecular analytic, molecular biology, biodefense research, and microelectronics. Living cells are then integrated into microchannel and microfluidic system, or what you call it, lab image. This containing this small or microtubules are put on this system and forming the glomerulus tubules and the loop of Henle, and they are connected together by connector, and there is blood in and out and another urine out. They can do also a fabricated of the proximal convoluted tubule with specific ink printed on a gelatin, fibrinogen, extracellular matrix, and additional of extra.
Implantable and wearable devices, يعني, it took a lot of time, but funding and costing and complications are still reflecting that it will not be applicable. I think the implantable type one of kidney, artificial by artificial kidney of San Francisco, probably. We met a lot of who invent the bioartificial kidney, the wearable device, and it's still more than 5 to 6 years trying to find a way to be applicable. But unfortunately, it will not. It's very complicated, and it will be applied for artificial intelligence in that system, as there is, should be a remote control and monitoring. So we hope that the implantable one, not the carried one or portable one, will be on the light, probably 2025. The problem is with the proximal tubular cells availability, and you need a lot of proximal tubules, and tissue culture is costing. That's why the bioartificial kidney, while we are talking about that for more than 6 to 7 years, is still not for a clinical use. Okay, we can take some while that on that. I think that it will not be, is it for sure a physiological way of dialyzing patients like CAPD? But unfortunately, the technology needs more and more inventions in that. Dr. Humes, who started that for RAD or renal tubular assisted devices 2006 and stopped shortly, just a few patients because of the funding for the renal tubules. Even the clinical trials had been stopped on that time. Yeah, yeah. They give some eliminating results of the acute kidney injury patients, but the lack of renal tubules and the funding of the system had been cut shortly. So the system as a whole had been broken from 2006 up till now. What is going on the light is the implantable one of San Francisco. Yes, exactly. Of multi-organ failure even, yeah. No, it's cut shortly. It's cut shortly because of funding and the availability of renal tubular cells. It's not an easy. It's not an easy way to implement an survived cells of proximal tubules into a membrane. That's my work. You need a scaphoid. So the attachment of the cells to the membrane is very difficult and should be attached as well on the outer layer of the membrane, not the inner layer of membrane, because it's much more porous. So you need the cells, you need the membrane, and you need an additional scaphoid so the renal tubules could be attached directly to the membrane.
Thank you.
So yeah, this is what this seems to be of some illuminating results of the implantable rather than the wearable device. We are still waiting for that for more physiological dialysis, which is meaning by more continuous way, so the patients for sure will have as a result of same dialysis as like renal replacement therapy by dialysis. So we should close that talk. So we have to thank Professor Dr. Hayam again just for highlighting what is awaiting for years for that.